competence is far behind us. As I'm a mathematician, I will try to prove this this assertion. So, so I will try to illustrate the approach which I will speak here about on two problems. As a forward problem, I will consider the well-known Sturm-Liouville problem on a half line. So where what one should find is the discrete spectral data, which means eigenvalues, if they exist, also some Norman constants. I will introduce all this here, and the spectral density function. So this is the most difficult part. I will explain also why it is difficult. I will show how this approach works for the inverse problems. And as an inverse problem, to illustrate how it works, I chose the inverse scattering problem on a whole line, which is very well known, and it's really needed to solve it in so many applications. So besides the well-known applications in classical quantum mechanics, I would like to mention this probably less known, probably now even more important applications, like the inverse scattering transform method for solving non-linear PDEs, such as the Korteweg-de Vries equation, the non-linear Schrödinger equation, and many others. So, for example, in the first talk of the day, in fact, what was considered what was called the Gross-Pitayevsky equation, sometimes it's just called the non-linear Schrödinger equation, and it's one of the example of the equations which can be solved by the inverse scattering transform method, for which, for applying this method, one needs to have a good method for solving the direct or forward scattering problem on the line and the inverse scattering problem on the line. So I will show how it can be done using this approach, which I will explain now. And in fact, it's almost the same as in the first point, the non-linear Fourier transform, which in fact also means in fact the same. You should solve, you should know how to solve the forward scattering problem and the inverse scattering problem. Probably for this Sturm-Liouville equation, probably for the so-called Zakharov-Shabbat system. It depends, in fact, on the applications, but in fact, it's more or less the same what I will talk here about. And why the nonlinear Fourier transform is so important, for example, because of the applications in nonlinear optical waveguides, optical fibers. For example, in fact, good algorithms, to have good algorithms for the non-linear Fourier transform, now to find them is, the absence of good algorithms, in fact, it's one of the main obstacles now in non-linear fiber optics. So, there are several strong groups in the world which work, in fact, in the development of the methods for finding the non-linear transform, Fourier transform. And in fact, what I hope is that this approach, which I will show you, is the right way to do it. Okay, so let us start with some classical stuff. So I will consider the forward Sturm-Liouville problem on a half line. So we will suppose, we should consider this Schrödinger equation on the half line, so x is greater than zero, and q satisfies this condition, which in fact means that q decays sufficiently fast at infinity. Okay, I would like to mention here that grows at infinity, computationally is much more easier, because you just need to put some virtual boundary and ask that your solution be zero at the boundary, and that's it. So in fact, it's more or less easy. When the potential decays, it's much more challenging computationally. So this is this case, and we will suppose that some initial condition is zero. Okay, this is a very standard setting of the problem on a half line. So what does it mean to solve this Sturm-Liouville problem on a half line? This means to find the discrete spectral data and the continuous spectral data. So in order to explain what they are, I need to introduce one more notation. So please, I will use this notation through the whole talk. I'm denoting by phi of lambda x the unique solution of this Cauchy problem. So what does it mean? It satisfies our Schrödinger equation and these initial conditions. In particular, if I have phi, it will satisfy this initial condition automatically. Yeah. So it is unique, of course, it exists, it is unique, I denote it by phi. Okay. In terms of this phi, what are these spectral data? Let us see. So the discrete spectral data, if there exists a discrete spectrum, it means the following, that there exists some values of lambda, which are called eigenvalues, such that these the corresponding solution phi of the Cauchy problem will belong to L2 at on the half line, which means the following, that it is a physical solution which decays at infinity. So there exists a good solution with a finite energy decaying at infinity. Okay. So probably there are no eigenvalues. Probably there are some, but if there are some eigenvalues, this is only a finite set, not more. So we should find also, besides this lambda n, the corresponding so-called norming constants, which means that in fact we should be able to compute the norms, the L2 norms of these eigenfunctions. Okay. So what is known, that the discrete spectral data can be empty, the set of discrete spectral data can be empty, can be not, but if it is not, then lambda n are all negative. It's very well known. Okay. Now, what is much more interesting, what I would like to mention here, is that there are quite a few papers, quite a few works dedicated to computation of the discrete spectrum. Because more or less it's clear how to do it. There are quite a lot of methods developed. But what is much more difficult is to find the spectral density function, and which is much more important, in fact. So, more precisely, even not the spectral density function itself, but nobody needs it. What is, in fact, needed is its derivative. Okay, of the spectral density function. So this derivative, I will call the function V of lambda. Why the derivative is needed and not the spectral density function? Because it can be seen, for example, from the well-known fact, which is called the spectral expansion theorem. In fact, the spectral expansion theorem is one of the possible definitions of the spectral density function. Okay. It says more or less the following, that any function from an appropriate class, I will not specify it, it's well known which kind of classes here can be considered, So any function f from an appropriate class defined on a half line admits this representation. So let us look more closely what is this. So phi is our solution of the Cauchy problem. Okay? So we change lambda here from 0 to infinity. For every value of lambda, we obtain the a solution of the Cauchy problem. Okay? Here, v of lambda is our derivative of the spectral density function. Okay? And f of lambda is the image of the function f under the generalized Fourier transform. Okay? So we take our solution of the Cauchy problem, we consider this integral with this function f, we obtain some image, this is the generalized Fourier transform, and in and here is how to invert this generalized Fourier transform. If the discrete spectrum is not empty, then it is represented by this part. So here you see again the solution of the Cauchy problem corresponding to every eigenvalue here, multiplied by the values of this f capital, which is the image of our function f small, and multiplied by the Norman constants. So all these spectral data are here, are present in the spectral expansion theorem. Why this spectral expansion theorem is so important? Well, it's too difficult to tell it in some words. But for example, if one wants to compute the Green function, okay, so this is how this spectral expansion theorem can be used for this. You obtained from here the expression for the Green functions. Many other things. So in fact, this is probably the most important fact of the spectral theory, in fact, this spectral expansion theorem. And here we see that we need the whole, the discrete spectral data and the continuous spectral data, which consists basically in the derivative of the spectral density function. Okay, hold here.
Is it absolutely necessary to multiply by your alpha n?
Of course. If not, you will not have the equality here. Yeah, it's. They are there. Okay, so all this can be found in classical books, like, for example, the book of Levitan, Marchenko, some other. Now, as I told you, so the, to compute in practice all these spectral data is really difficult. So the discrete spectrum you can find in many works, but for computing the spectral density function, in fact, there exists not so many works. I should mention here, first of all, the book of John Price, which is the in fact the Bible about the numerical solution of Sturm-Liouville problems. The very last section of this book is dedicated to some words about the computation of the spectral density function. In fact, the whole this section is dedicated to explaining why it is so difficult. Okay, so just one example. So this is the quotation from the book. The computation is expensive. For this, in one example, he presents the computation of the spectral density function in several points with tolerance 10 to minus 5. Okay? So for this, a total of 153,960 eigenvalues and eigenfunction norms were computed. So here, just some words. Why it is really difficult to compute the spectral density function? Because the usual approach in numerical mathematics, if you have something infinite, So first to consider something finite, which somehow approximates the infinite. Yeah? But here the problem is the following. So we are solving the Sturm-Liouville problem on a half line. Okay. So okay. One can think that if we choose some interval quite big, okay, somehow big, probably what we find in this finite interval will approximate the whole stuff on the half line. No, okay, this is not the way to do it. Why? Because any Sturm-Liouville problem considered on a finite interval will give you just a discrete spectrum. So we'll give you an infinite set of eigenvalues, and that's it. And how to approximate with it the spectral density function of the half line is nothing clear. Okay? It is not clear at all. So in fact, one of the classics of the spectral theory, Titchmarsh, invented many years ago a procedure how to one can approximate the spectral density function on the half line by solving many problems on the finite intervals. And this is what was realized precisely by the people mentioned on this slide. So precisely this technique of Titchmarsh. And of course it is expensive, and of course one should solve many of such problems, find hundreds of thousands eigenvalues and eigenfunctions norms in order to approximate at least in some points the spectral density function. So what I will present to you is a completely new approach which in fact trivializes this problem. Okay. So the first step is, I need to introduce the so-called Jost solution, which itself is interesting if you, for people who study quantum mechanics, what is Jost solution, I think it is superfluous to explain, but anyway. So when Q is real valued, for example, here just for to do it really easy to understand, I consider the easiest setting of the problem. Okay, so Q is real valued. Q once more satisfies this condition, which means the decay at infinity, quite fast decay at infinity. By rho, I will always denote the square root of lambda here, and I choose it such that the imaginary part of rho is always on the upper half plane, complex plane. Okay, so what is very well known is that under these conditions, the equation for the Schrödinger equation possesses the unique so-called Jost solution. What is the Jost solution, which I denote here by this letter E, and which depends on rho and on x? It is just a solution which behaves at infinity as an exponential function. Okay, so for any rho, the Jost solution, which exists and is unique for this equation, behaves at infinity like an exponential function and something smaller. Okay. So, to find all the spectral data, in fact, can be reduced to find the Jost solution for any value of rho. Okay, I will explain it a little bit later. But
why
first,
why rho, the imaginary part of rho, could be bigger than zero, equal than zero? Why?
Why not? Why not? It can be zero, but it also important to consider it bigger than zero. So let us don't restrict to the real line. Okay. So the fact, what is also known since at least 56 Okay, that the this just solution admits the following so-called Levin representation. Okay, so why it is important? Why it is important? So what is it? It is just an integral operator, okay, applied to the exponential function with a good kernel. At least a for every x fixed belongs to the L2 space. And the most important is that the kernel doesn't depend on the spectral parameter. Okay? It's independent of rho. This is important. So for every rho, you have such a transformation. It is known that it exists. So for example, this term Levin representation, you can find in this very well-known book by Chardin Sabatier, Inverse Problems in Quantum Scattering Theory. Now, of course, this Levin representation is very good, but the problem is how to find this kernel A. Okay. This is what I've just told you, that in fact we have that this integral operator transforms solutions of the elementary equation into solutions of the less elementary equation with the potential Q. Okay? More about this transmutation or transformation operators can be found in this book, in Levitan, in this survey, and so on, in many other works. Now what follows? I can tell you that, in fact, quite elementary tools are used, okay, but the results are surprising. So the first elementary tool is the following. Let us see. So from the fact that A is in the L2 space from x to infinity, it follows immediately that if I just construct this auxiliary function A small, it will belong to this space L2 from 0 to infinity with this weight. Okay. It's more or less immediate, it's very easy to see. Now, if I'm already in this space, then in this space there is a government, which is called the Laguerre polynomials, which form the orthogonal, in fact, orthonormal basis in this space. Okay. So, it means that I know that A small lives in this space, then it's immediate that it admits such a representation, okay? Where Ln are Laguerre polynomials, and An we should find somehow, the coefficients. But let us first apply this, okay? So, first of all, we come back to the kernel A capital. We obtain for this kernel such a representation. Okay. Now, we still don't know what to do with the coefficients. Okay. But we know that such a representation exists, that in the sense of L2 it converges, so we can use it, we can substitute it into the representation for the just solution. Okay. So we just take it and substitute here. So we will need to integrate only the Laguerre polynomials multiplied by the exponential functions, and they can be integrated explicitly. So what we obtain from here is that the just solution admits such a representation. Okay? Such a representation. So here even shouldn't think, because it's automatic, yeah, that a new notation should be here introduced. Yeah, it's quite trivial that from here we see that we should introduce this new parameter z, okay, defined in this way, and in terms of this z, the just solution just takes this form. So, in fact, it's simply the power series in terms of the parameter z. Okay. Now, what to do with the coefficients, an? In fact, what happens, it's more or less, it's trivial. So now, having this solution in such a form, we just substitute it into equation. And from the equation, we obtain certain recurrent integration procedure, which I will not present it here, just because it's more or less easy, and it's more or less like the SPPS method, which was seen here in several occasions during the conference. But what is important here? So in practice, one can compute 200, 300 of these coefficients an of x without any problems. But what is most important here? First of all, is that the very first coefficient a naught, okay, is the following, is the just solution corresponding to the parameter rho equal to I over 2, okay, multiplied by the exponential minus 1. And all of them, it can be shown rigorously that all of these coefficients, they tend to zero when x tends to infinity, okay, which is not trivial, in fact, that it happens. It's not expected, but this is the fact. And all these coefficients, as I told you, can be constructed by recurrent integration procedure, which is quite simple. Now, we have some estimates, which always is important. So if we consider the truncated series, okay, then these estimates can be shown. So when the imaginary part of rho is greater than zero, then we have this estimate, which roughly speaking tells us that greater is the imaginary part of rho, better is the estimate. Okay. And for the for real rho, we just have the equality, which is trivially obtained from these L2 considerations. So the difference between the exact solution and the approximate solution in the L2 norm is can be estimated quite easily. Okay. Now, just I should mention that for finding the whole spectral data, besides the just solution itself, one needs also its derivative. Its derivative with respect to x, and we need also a good way to find the to compute the derivative. So here we repeat the whole process to find the good representation for. But the derivative, find it more or less in a similar way. So it's again practically the power series with respect to z plus something else, and with the coefficients which easily can be found from the coefficients of the previous series, and with analogous estimates for the derivative also. Now. So, if we compute the just solution, then we can find the whole spectral data. So, first of all, the eigenvalues will be just zeros of this expression. Okay. Now, the norming constants, they can be computed from this equality, where delta 1 is the derivative of this expression with respect to lambda, which if you use the conventional computational methods, it's very difficult, on the contrary, to find the derivative with respect to lambda. Okay, but the most difficult anyway is to compute this function v of lambda, which has such a representation. So it is just this expression with the same delta of rho, with rho greater than zero. So in fact, in terms of the just solution and its derivative, you can find the whole spectral data which you need. Okay. And now, this representation which we obtained is so interesting, in fact. First of all, one should notice the following, that this transform, that this mapping from the spectral parameter rho, okay, for example, just 1 second, for example, we need here rho greater than zero. So we need to compute something on a half-life, which is difficult, okay? Computationally always difficult. But now, in terms of z, so when rho lives on the upper half-plane, then z lives just in the unit disk, okay, on the complex plane. So z in the unit disk. And to compute this delta of rho means, in terms of z, to calculate this expression, which consists basically of power series in terms of z. So the eigenvalues correspond to zeros of this expression when z lives in this interval from -1 to 1. When z goes to -1, it means that lambda goes to -infinity. And z equal to 1 corresponds to lambda equal to 0. So this expression for the Norman constants also is easily computed from here. But most important is the following. Now, look. In order to find the eigenvalues, we need to find zeros of this previous expression here from -1 to 1. And to find the function v of lambda, which is the derivative of the spectral density function, we need to compute a simple expression just on this upper half circle. Okay? And this expression is just this one, where phi was on the previous slide. So the computation, in fact, is trivial, okay, in this case, because we reduce the infinity to upper half circle. And as an example, I will show you just one numerical example for this problem. So when q is exponent of exponential function of minus x, then the exact delta of rho can be found. Okay, it has such a form where these are Bessel functions with complex orders, which is also a good challenge to compute them numerically. Okay, but this is the exact result. When h in the initial condition, the constant h is -1, then there exists one eigenvalue. Lambda 1 is more or less this constant. Now, the computation of the very first Jost solution, which corresponds to rho equal to I over 2, was performed by the SPPS method. Why not? It works very well. So its accuracy was of order 10 to minus 14. Okay. And then the recurrent integration procedure to find the several next coefficients an was performed also. It's quite easy. So the numerical result, so we compare now the numerical result which was obtained with our representation against the exact values. So the here is how the eigenvalue is computed. This is the difference between the exact one and the approximate one. So already with n equal to 9, here we obtain this precision, so it's not a challenge, in fact. But what is more important and more interesting is that this derivative of the spectral density function is also easily and rapidly computed and approximated. So here you can see how many terms we needed. Here you can see what is the precision. So it's practically of this order. And here is how it looks like. So this is the graph of V of lambda, okay? And usually how it is done. So you have an exact solution, you have a numerical solution. So you take the graph of the exact solution and put the points which correspond to your numerical solution. Okay, here is not the case because the exact solution is very difficult to compute. This Bessel functions of complex order, this is a real challenge. So these red squares correspond to the exact solution. Okay, and with the blue line, which is obtained in seconds, in fact. The blue line here is the numerical solution V of lambda, which was obtained by our method. Okay, which is, in fact, compared to what John Price reported and other people reported about this, the solving these problems about finding the spectral density function is another world. So, at the moment, no other algorithm can do more or less something similar to what we are presenting here. Okay, now how to use this approach to solve the inverse problems. Okay, you can think that the inverse problems are much more complicated. In fact, no. This is what I will explain to you now. Okay. So, as an example of an inverse problem, we consider the inverse scattering problem on the whole line. So this is the Schrödinger operator. Q is still the real value function defined on the whole line and satisfying now the same condition of decay at infinity, but already at both at infinities, at minus infinity and plus infinity. Okay. So what is the inverse scattering problem? You are given the scattering data. Okay. Scattering data, which consists of the reflection coefficient. Okay, there is some reflection coefficient, even if you don't know what is it, you can imagine that there is one. Okay, in physics, there is one reflection coefficient, always. So, you are given the reflection coefficient, and you are given the discrete spectral data, which consists of the eigenvalues, if they exist. Probably they don't exist, but if they exist, there are some finite number of these eigenvalues and the corresponding Norman constants, which are also some expressions of the norms of the corresponding eigenfunctions. Okay, so you are given the spectral data, you should find the potential Q. This is the inverse scattering problem. And in many applications, what is more important, in fact, that you should solve many of such inverse scattering problems in no time, okay, practically. Many, many problems very quickly in order to, for example, to find the nonlinear Fourier transform. Okay, so how we will do it? We will use the very well-known so-called Gelfand-Levitan-Marchenko equation, okay? There is a prejustice in all this theory that the Gelfand-Levitan-Marchenko equation, they cannot be used for numerical stuff. Okay? Because many people try to use them for numerical computation and more or less fail. So, in fact, I will not solve the Gelfand-Levitan-Marchenko equation. I will use it to construct a system of equations which I need, okay, to solve the inverse scattering problem. So the first step is we just part from the Gelfand-Levitan-Marchenko equation, which is fantastic discovery. Okay? Because if one just tried to think from where it appeared. It's not clear how first Gelfand and Levitan came to this result. In effect is fantastic. Then Marchenko did it for the infinite interval. First it was done for the finite interval. So what is this result? What is this equation? We are given the scattering data, and we can construct the function f capital, given the scattering data, in the following way. So here we have this the discrete spectrum represented, okay, and with the Norman constants corresponding. And here this function r, which is constructed if the reflection coefficient is given. So given the scattering data, we construct the function f capital, okay, and then most surprisingly, the kernel from the Levin representation, the kernel from the Levin representation, A capital, satisfies this Fredholm equation of second kind, okay, but on the infinite interval, which is an inconvenient fact. Now, so this is the first step. So we have the scattering data, we find, we have this equation for our kernel A. And now we just do the following. We just do the following. So we substitute this this expression, this representation for the kernel A. We know it exists. In this case, we don't know nothing about the coefficients A, and because this is the inverse problem, we should find, okay, the kernel A. So, but we know it. We substitute it into the Gelfand-Levitan equation. And after some tricks, okay, not very complicated, we arrive at a linear system of algebraic equations, just linear algebraic equations, where the right-hand side, Fn, is constructed in this way. So here is the discrete spectrum, here is the continuous spectrum with our reflection coefficient S. And the matrix of the system has this form. Okay, so if you have the scattering data, you construct all this. But most importantly is that from the whole, so you can see the system, it's infinite, so you tell me, okay, what is the point? Yeah. So still you should solve it. But the most interesting here is that I don't need the whole solution this system. Okay, I don't need to find the whole set of the coefficients an. I just need to find the very first one, the a naught, the a zero. Okay, why? Because I know that I have this representation for a zero. So if I just express from here the Jost solution. So to find the A naught means to find this Jost solution. And if I know a solution of my Schrödinger equation, it means that I know the potential Q. So Q, in fact, can be expressed from A naught just like it is written here. So from the whole system, I just need the very first coefficient, A naught. Okay? And so what should be done is just I compute some first Fm and some first Amn, solve this truncated system, find just A naught, compute this Q from A naught, and see what happens. Okay. So what happens, for example, we can see first this example. Q in this case is just is this potential. Here everything can be done explicitly, so it is a good example. And here is how it looks like in numerical, so the result. Here the circles are the recovered potential, okay? The recovered potential, and the blue line is the exit potential. So here the absolute error of the recovered potential is 10 to minus 2 with just 10 equations. When we take 20 equations in the system, then the order of the absolute error is already 10 to minus 5. It works in seconds. So it's immediate. So what is important to mention here is also that all the existing methods. I'm not speaking about this problem, because for this problem practically there are no methods, okay, existing numerical, just to solve these inverse scattering problems. There are some works which I know, and some, I would say, partial results. But in fact, for all inverse spectral problems, finite interval, infinite interval, the methods which exist are iterative, which means the following, that you should guess first more or less what is your potential. Okay? You take this potential, you solve the forward spectral problem, you compare the results obtained, then you should have some algorithm to make the second guess, the third guess, to propose every time the new potential. Okay, this is the iterative method. So all the existing methods, which are more or less decent, they are iterative. This is not. This method is not iterative, it's completely direct. So you take your scattering data, you construct the linear system of algebraic equations, you solve it, and you obtain your potential. So this is completely new, and for me it's really surprising that only elementary tools were used to obtain this. Okay, and just to finish, I would like to point out some bibliography. So for the regular problems, it means finite interval, good potential Q. Okay, here is. Here are two works where we solve the forward regular problems with this approach on finite intervals. Here is for singular Bessel type problems, also on finite intervals. There are two works, and the inverse Sturm-Liouville problem on a finite interval, which I didn't present here, because here there are some other methods which more or less compete, okay, with ours. But the same approach for the finite interval can be found here in this work. And finally, thank you very much for your attention. Just the real line, but the whole plane. I see.
Adaptation in this sense for resonances.
I see.
In that case, you may get divergence, no? Because you have a complex exponential.
Yes.
So if you have a complex rock, you are going to get a real exponential. But you need to impose that condition, otherwise you are going to have a divergent exponential. No, maybe you don't want.
But I will not consider the same just solution in this case. Okay. Okay, I will consider the other one.
But even in your Z function, you have both at rho equals
yes.
Minus I rho.
Yes.
So that's why you're imposing the imaginary part to be greater than zero. To avoid the pole.
Right? Yes.
Which also answers this question.
Yes. No, it's you see, this is not the case. This pole automatically arises at the
negative
half plane, yes, just because it was chosen from the very beginning that the imaginary part of rho is. This is not my supposition. Okay, it's just the nature. It happens.
But it's also in the way in which you define your set function.
Yes, of course.
Yes.
So in the inverse problem, I wonder about the uniqueness of the unit. So you have this set of the value.
Scattering data, yes, there is the uniqueness. It's very well described already.
So the transmission or reflection coefficient is the spectral density.
Yeah.
Completely defines the potential.
Yes.
Not the possibility of constructing families of potential that have the same, that lead to the same spectral density and reflection.
Okay. There are a lot of bibliography about this thing. So what I didn't tell at all, what kind of function can be this reflection coefficient, okay? Because in order to speak about the unicity of the uniqueness of the solution, you need to define, so you take S from such class, so the numbers should be more or less of this kind. I didn't speak about this at all. So if you take from a certain class this function S, then automatically you will have a uniqueness. Yes, if you slightly change this class, which can be interesting from the practical point of view, then you can obtain what you are speaking about. Okay, different potentials corresponding to some slightly different spectral data.
Yes.
Is there any possibility to obtain complex potentials from
I cannot answer you immediately. So the scheme is general. Okay. What happens with complex? I just should study first. Okay. But in fact, I think yes. But many you know many theorems here, which lead to all this, somehow need that Q be real valued. There are papers where the same is done. I mean, the same, for example, this Levin representation for Q being complex valued. So there are a lot of, but this work is quite delicate, so I cannot just give you an answer. Yes.
Yes. When you extend for the full line.
Yes. I need, but not for the inverse problem. For the forward problem, of course, I need both Jost solutions for both infinities. Yes. But this construction for one infinity works also for another. Sorry?
Minus infinity,
the
Jost function is right,
but it's
the same.
It's e to minus I rho x. X, and the also there is such a representation from minus infinity to X with another kernel.
Okay.
So you just instead of X you take minus X and repeat the whole procedure.
Some other questions? Okay. Can the inverse approach be applied to the case where we have complex
potential eigenvalues? this is more or less the same question as Professor Sara. In principle, yes, but there the problems are really delicate. You know, you change slightly the setting of the problem, and you can obtain completely different results. So I should see the problem, I should study it well in order to answer such a question. Okay. So I think should be also working, because it's really general, this approach. Okay, but it should be done practically for every problem separately.
Some other questions? If not, on behalf of the organizing committee, we have this answer.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Let us thank you.